So, just so you get an idea, I've worked for Navico, which owns Lowrance, Simrad, B&G for going on 20 years now on their pro staff. So, I've seen the stuff come for many years and, you know, get around and touch it. I do a lot of fishing, like Ed was saying. I spend a lot of time in Puget Sound in the wintertime. In fact, we just brought the boat from fishing winter blackmouth down here, and in the summertime, it's parked on the coast. So we're down in there doing Westport for salmon, tuna, halibut, all that kind of stuff. So we get around. Be happy to take questions as we go here, or you can ask it probably for Justin's benefit. We'll get to the end of it here. But anyway, let's get started. So no matter what you guys fish for, right, whether you're out there doing halibut, you got to be able to find these fish. And this is where your electronics can come in. And being able to work them and get them to operate correctly is going to help you a lot locating fish. All right, so salmon, of course, many of us are salmon anglers. You know, being able to find a bait, figure out where the fish are in relationship to it. Ocean's a big place. We're all offshore anglers. There's techniques that help you locate it. And there's a lot of new stuff out on the market that makes it a lot easier to locate fish. Okay? So that's the kind of ones we're after. Yeah, this was just the other day when we were up fishing, so this is what we do in the wintertime up in Washington. Okay, bottom fish. I know a lot of halibut and lingcod guys around here. So, sea bass, all that stuff. You got to be able to find a structure. You got to figure out what the fish are in relationship to. And, okay, guys who fish the lake, same thing. Trout, kokanee, that kind of thing. Lots of, you got to be able to locate where the school of fish are. So see if I can help you out just a little bit today. All right? One of our favorites around here, of course, tuna. Being able to get out there and locate the schools of tuna, be able to drop on them, you know, saves you a lot of time trying to figure out where they are in relationship to the boat. Okay? A lot of fun. Of course, on my boat, we have a little initiation for the new guys. They get their helmets, so. They think it's funny until they take it off, and then they go, what's that on my head? It won't wash off. So it's kind of fun. We have a good time with it. All right, of course, you're river fishermen, you know, same thing. You got to locate the drops. You got to be able to figure out where the sturgeon are at, where the salmon are holding. And then even the big water, when we're out fishing big water, you know, you got to be able to figure out where that bait is and where the fish are at. And even crab, being able to locate where your crab are in relationship, where other guys' pots are, you don't want to drop on them. I'll show you a few slides on that, too. All right, so most of us are familiar with sonar, right? We understand how it works. You basically got a sound wave that's going to go down, hit the bottom, come back, and echo back and return, right? So we all got that figured out. Okay, this is what we're trying to find, the arch, correct? Everybody wants to see the arch, all right? How many guys see the arch every day when I go out fishing? Okay, a couple guys. How many guys see the arch on the box when you bought the unit? Okay, everybody. All right, let's see if we can figure that out a little bit, make it work a little better for you. All right. So part of it's power. All right. If you're trying to find fish in 300-400 feet of water and you're using the unit doesn't have enough power, that's going to affect it. So you want to make sure you have enough power to the transducer to be able to return. So that's one of the key things. So if you got a, you know, 5-year-old $99 fish finder and you're going out tuna fishing, you're probably going to have a little trouble seeing the fish down deeper. All right. Just an example. Okay, so why do fish show as an arch? Okay, it has to do when they enter the cone. All right, so these fish move through. As he moves through the cone angle, he enters it. You can see a half arch, a partial arch. As he exits it, comes through the cone, you're going to get that perfect arch. And there's a few tricks to be able to make that happen, which we'll get to. All right, so, you know, as he starts moving through, it depends on where he is in relationship to the transducer. You got your transducer up here. As he moves in, it's going to show, as he starts to come through, you're going to pick up the signal. Remember, this is our newest information. As it starts to come through, as the fish, this is going to be directly under the boat. Everything else is history as we move across here. So we got this fish. He's coming through. As he starts to exit my cone, boom, all of a sudden now I start to see the arch forming. Okay. A lot of it's going to do with the cone angle. All right, so we're sitting here. If I'm running a 200 degree, or, you know, it's going to be a narrower cone. It's going to give me much better definition. So what I see is going to be a lot clearer. All right. If I'm running a 50, it's going to cover a wider area, but it's not going to be as defined. Okay. Example of that would be, how many guys are familiar with the flashlights where you can adjust the beam on them? Same kind of thing. If I turn it to a real narrow beam, I got a really bright light in one spot, right? That's like your 200. If I open that beam up, it's not as bright, but it covers a wider area. That's what happens with a 50. Okay. Now you can imagine, you drive this boat and you pull into a dock, you might get a couple questions. It usually starts out with, I have a problem, which now means I have a problem. So, all right, but you get, you know, you see a lot of stuff. I mean, you get to cover a lot of stuff because people come up immediately and, you know, start asking you questions and stuff. So, and we try to help them out as much as we can. But typically, I have found that it narrows it down to a couple different things that become issues with these units. And the first is power, okay? You gotta have power to them. You gotta have what we call clean power, or dedicated power. All right, so the best way to wire these things in is you want to have a power coming from your battery source up to wherever you're going to connect them. So let's say I got it on my dash. I'm going to run a dedicated line, maybe 10-gauge wire, up to that source. I'm going to have a negative and positive. That'll be fused. And then I tie all my electronics to that. That eliminates a lot of the background and interference that you get from other things in the boat. Okay? These new electronics, the modern stuff, man, the worst thing you can do is guys will go in there and we'll run across this more often than anything. They go, they buy a $3,000 fish finder, they set it on their dash, they plug it in, they go find power, and they're like, well, I don't need this compass light. Cut it, they wire it in, and they're like, the thing, it's got to have enough power to operate, you know? So even though it's 12 volt, you're not getting enough amps through it, okay? So you got to make sure you got enough amps. So it eliminates a lot of issues by doing that. If you get the power up there, and you get it dedicated, and you get enough to it, you're going to find out. One of the sure signs that that's an issue for you, you turn your boat on to go start your motors and your light dims on your sonar, okay, you're robbing it, all right, which means you're not getting enough power to it. So don't do that. It's not good for the units. Okay, the other issue, a couple guys, more than one of you guys, and I won't say who it was, have come by the booth when I'm updating units and said, I can't see my bottom when I'm running. As soon as I go up on plane, I lose bottom, okay? So that's an issue with where the transducer's mounted, okay, and how you mount it. You got to be able to get clean water across this deucer to be able to get it to perform. So mounting transducers is the other big issue that people seem to have problem with. So when you mount these things, you want to get them down below the boat, but more importantly, you want to get them where you're not going to have anything interfering with them. All right. So there can't be anything in front of them, no lifting strakes, no intakes, anything that's going to create air bubbles down the hull that's going to interfere with that deucer, whether it's a through hull or a transom mount, is going to cause an issue. Okay, so that's why, guys, you got these mounted up on your transom, right? And you back up, you're pulling out of the dock, and you lose bottom. It's because the motor's kicking all that, the bubbles underneath there. Same thing's happening when you go up on a plane. If you got something creating air bubbles underneath the boat, you're gonna lose bottom, all right? So take the time, figure out where it needs to be, get it mounted correctly. If you don't know, ask one of the guys that knows what they're doing. They'd show you. There's a lot of marine dealers around here. Okay, so what's wrong with this one? I get these pictures all the time. People will email them to me and go, hey, this is, I'm not picking up bottom when I'm running. I said, I'd look at it and I go, is that a jet sled by chance? And he goes, no, this is my offshore boat. Okay, well, just checking, but the problem here is the transducer's mounted too high. So what I told him is take where the red arrow is, move that part down to the blue arrow. All right, so what I'm saying to the guys, I want to get this thing mounted down below the boat. So, on the package, it will tell you a lot of times to mount it even, split the transducer half and half. You're better to go just a little bit farther down. Get it a little underneath the hull, get it down where this part here is actually below the hull, and then give it a slight tilt down. All right, so you want to slightly tilt it. That way you're gonna pick up nice clean water across the transducer. All right, that will help eliminate the bubble issue. You should be able to run quite fast and pick up bottom. I mean, it's not an issue. I have my boat. Here I'm 700 feet and I'm doing 33 miles an hour and I'm picking up bottom. Okay, so it's just a matter of mounting it correctly, getting it mounted, you'll eliminate all that issue. Okay, the other thing to keep in mind with these transducers, these are wear items, okay? There is a reason I cut the cord off on these. All right, they wear out. There's a crystals in there, they ping constantly. They're always pinging. Okay, the other thing to watch for, that will go out, you can put your hand on here and feel if they're working or not when they're pounding. You'll feel that signal, okay? The other thing is they get beat up. They're dragging through the water, they're gonna get hit. This is nice and smooth like a baby's butt, right? When it feels like it's somebody shot it with a shotgun and it's all gravelied up, that might be a sign it's time to change this out. Okay, most of the pros that do a lot of tournament fishing, we swap these things out every 2 to 3 years. We change our transducers out, particularly if they're getting beat up, all right? Just a point. So. If you notice you're starting to lose imaging that you had before, that could be an issue. Yeah?
Is that the same as far as the transducer level and angle and not only Lowrance, but almost all?
Yeah, pretty much. You'll find that other than a few stock transducers, Airmar makes majority of transducers. The difference between mine and somebody else's is the plug.
I got a Garmin.
The plug is different on the end of it.
But as far as like a Garmin, you set that transducer.
Mm-hmm. It's exactly the same. They all work the same way. Yep, pretty much.
Paint
them? Yeah, you can paint the tops with regular bottom paint, but the bottom you want to paint with transducer paint. Okay, they have a regular, it comes in a little bottle, you can paint it, you want to use that. That's what I do to mine, yeah. Especially if you're going to leave it in the water. Otherwise, exactly what you said, you'll have seaweed and barnacles growing on it, will definitely affect the operation. Okay, a couple versions of transducers. Okay, that's a 200, in case you didn't know. That's a 5200, all right? Just, you can see a little bit size difference. Here's an example, again, 5200, this is a 1 kilowatt. All right, a little bit bigger. A lot of the offshore guys like to run these, okay? A little bit bigger transducer, a little bit better performance. All right, then we have a structure scan up here. This thing working. Okay, so guy comes and yells at me at the boat, Doc. I'm at the ramp, and he says, hey, I can't get my sonar to work right. And I said, okay. I said, it's not a Lowrance. He goes, no. He said, well, you might want to lower the transducer down a little bit. You got it just a little high. It's probably why you're not paying. And I said, how's your GPS work? And he says, not worth a damn. I said, well, I can believe that. And I said, you may want to mount it up hotter. So that's what I'm saying. Guys get irritated about things, and you're like, you know, there's a thing called an instruction manual. Sometimes it's good to look at it before you start going on. I tell people this story, they don't believe me. So, okay, now there are some things you can do to maximize, to optimize the operation of your unit, regardless of what you're running. All right, first off, normally there'll be something in the menu that says sonar installation, right? All right, so under sonar installation, there'll be a transducer type, okay? So if you open that up and I was click on it, you're gonna get a list of all these different transducers. And immediately you'll go, oh my God, how do I know which one I got? You know, and you run around the thing trying to figure out, well, is it this one or is it this? It's this big, is what I hear all the time, or it's this big. I'm like, okay, guys, the best way to figure it out, this is the plug, the power plug that goes in the back of the unit, okay? The transducer plug, where the transducer plugs in. There's a tag on there, a little silver tag. It has the number of the transducer on it. That's the one you want to input into this. Because immediately, once you do that, you tell the unit, hey, this is the transducer I'm using. Now all of a sudden it goes, oh, okay. Because the sonar comes out of, you know, our case, it comes out of Tulsa. It doesn't know if it's going on a bass boat, it's going on an offshore boat. It doesn't know. So you, by optimizing it and telling it what I'm going to try to use it for, immediately you're going to get better performance out of it. Okay, make sense? All right, so select the transducer.
What if it doesn't have a tag on it?
Then send me a picture. I can usually figure it out. Or anybody that deals with marine electronics will be able to look at it right away and go tell you what it is. All right, on their installation. Okay, so now I got it selected. I got my transducer in there. Boom. Okay, next thing you'd like to know is, what's the average water depth they fish? All right, so you'll go in there under fishing mode, and generally, ours say general use is what they come in. General use is like 0 to 5,000 feet. All right, so I'm probably not going to fish at 5,000 feet all the time. So if I want to optimize the unit, I'm going to select the water depth I want in. So shallow water would be 0 to 60, fresh water would be 0 to 400. So yeah, fish is fresh water, but I'm going to put it, I fish in salt water, but I'm going to put it in a fresh water mode because that's primarily what I fish in. All right, so I would select that. How do I know which one to select? Okay, there's a chart in your owner's manual. Okay, so if you figure it out, you're going to get it in a fresh water mode, it'll be in there. So here's my 400 feet. Does that mean it won't work if I go outside of that depth? No, it just means that this is where I spend the majority of my time. If I'm a river guy or a lake guy, I might want to leave it in shallow water mode, but for the most, 90% of the guys, this is where they select. And then, does that mean it won't work out tuna fishing? No, it doesn't mean anything at all. It means I could do some deals to optimize it to tuna fish by switching over to a deep water mode, but boom. You know, I could do the same thing by switching my transducer over, so going into 50. All right, if you you don't know where the manual is and you lost it, you can get it off the webpage, or you can go into your manual page on the newer units and it's right there. It's on the unit, it's built in. So you can open it up while you're out there and go, oh yeah, that's what I'm supposed to do. Now I remember. Okay, now ping speed. Okay, the rate the unit's operating, boom, sending a signal down. All right, most of the newer units, they'll have some kind of selection here, it'll say ping speed. You want to be up toward the upper range, like 18 to max, somewhere in that range. I like to be at least 18 or above on the broadbands. That kind of fires the broadband off and gets it working in full mode. So get up to that 18, the higher range of your ping speed. Okay, scroll speed. Okay, that's the speed that the unit is going to move across the screen. All right, so why is that important? Because most of the time it's in normal or one or two. All right, so our newest information is here. This is all history, right? This is a zoom on this side. So it's moving across here. By speeding it up just a little bit, it gives that thing, the chart, a chance for that arch to form a little better, because the chart's moving just a little quicker, and it spreads that arch out, where you might see this, because it's going really slow, getting across there by the time you get across. Now that it moves up, now you spread that arch out, it makes it a lot easier to see. So if you pick up your your scroll speed just a little bit, that's going to improve your picture that you're going to see on the unit. Okay, palettes, that's the color background. Up here in the northwest, it comes in number one when you get it. The majority of the units I see are always in number one. 13 is a good one too. The white with the yellow, you know, shows the dense colors as yellow or red up in that range. So we usually call it lucky 13, works really well for salmon fishing and tuna fishing. Okay, so sensitivity. Now this is key to all of them, no matter what you run. You want to adjust your sensitivity every time you change depths a lot. Okay, on the Lowrance units, you can leave it in auto and still adjust the sensitivity, all right? So what I'll do is I'll bump it up. So let's say I pulled in 173 feet of water. I want to adjust my sensitivity really quick. I just run it up until it blacks out the screen, and I'll start running it back down again. Okay, I'll go, still got a little bit of interference in there. I'll just bring it down just a little bit more. Boom, it cleared up. But yeah, I can still see the bait, see the small stuff. Real important to do that. That will give you a much better picture of what you're seeing. All right, allows you to see those fish form a lot better. So do that. You know, it's real important when you're going from this depth to 50 feet of water and back. Yeah, you can leave it in automatic. Yeah, it will work. But if you're really trying to zoom in on the fish, adjusting your sensitivity is probably the best thing you can do on any unit.
Excuse me.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll show you some pictures here in a second. This would be starting to see some bait right in here. Just start forming, but there's better bait balls. We'll get to it.
So that's not interference? Nope,
that's not interference, no. You'll see interference tends to be the vertical lines that you see that comes in here. Typically that happens when you get by somebody else that's using the same frequency you are. All right, how many guys fish with the fish symbols? Okay, don't raise your hand. I just saved you. Alright, so the only thing more irritating than fish symbols is fish symbols with beeps. They probably has a place if you're doing a TV show and you're anchored fishing for bluefin tuna. Might have a place. Everywhere else doesn't work that effectively. Okay, so the little fishies, you'd rather learn to read the arches. Okay, so take it off of that if you're running it. Leave it in the normal mode and learn how to read arches. You'll read a lot better. You'll get a lot better. Okay. Other things you can do with these, system controls. One of the things you can do is, these units are amazing nowadays. The amount of information that you can transcribe on the screen and just look at it as you're running. So that it's called edit overlay data, okay? So if I go in here, I can select any of these options and put up on the screen by hitting that. I come up and pick it up. I can put, well, this is a barometer off the motor. I can pick up my battery voltage, my time. Of course, the temp in the water, I can make them bigger or smaller. I can move them around anywhere on the screen I want. Here's my port engine, my starboard engine temperatures. Here's the amount of fuel I got left. How amount of fuel I'm burning. Whatever I want to see on any page of the screen, I can put on there. So if I'm on radar, I can have the same information on that screen. I can put anything that I want. So it's real easy to do once you learn how to do it, and it's very effective. So I don't have to look down at this gauge, I don't have to look at this gauge. I'm running the boat, I can see everything that's important to me. Okay. Another neat thing to have, if you're trying to diagnose a problem with a unit, they'll be in there. Somewhere in there is going to be a device list. And what that tells you, it's a network. Under ours, it's under system, network, device list. That will show you everything that's connected to the boat on that network that you got. So if you're saying, I'm not seeing, for instance, my radio, my VHF radio is not on there. If it's not on this list, it's not connected properly. That's the fastest way to tell. If I turn it on and I call up this list and it's connected to the network, I should see it on there. If I don't see it on there, there's a clue right away that I got an issue. So that's one of the first things I do if I go on somebody's boat. I bring this up and I'll look to see if they got an engine sensor. I'm looking to see if they're reading it. Whatever that they have in the boat, you know, autopilot, whatever it is, should show up on that list.
What's the number of brackets for? Is that the number of items that it's sensing off the, like, your Evinrude?
Points, yeah. Number of points. Okay, you can go in, tuna fishermen, real critical. You go in there, you want your water temperature to be right dead on, right? You can go in there and calibrate it. All right, you can do plus or minus. You can chart it too. I mean, you can graph it. You can have a minimum. So your calibration, what it's going to be, you can go in there and change that. So that's available under the water temperature. It'll be in there with the transducer setup. So I typically have one of those thermal thermometers when I'm getting ready to do my tuna deal, and I'll get out there right by the transducer where I know it's taking the sensor. I'll get a reading off of that and compare it to what's on this. And then I always ask the guy next to me, did I know this fish and tuna really well? I said, what's your temperature say right now? Between the three, you know, you can usually get pretty close. So if you're always reading higher or lower than everybody else, you may want to go in and calibrate your water temperature. Okay, you heard a lot about, Ed was mentioned, we do product updates. How do you know if you need an update? Okay, well, there's several ways. One is you can go into about in a unit. Normally it'll tell you in there somewhere what the current version is. If the update's higher than the version that's in your unit, then it's updatable. Okay, pretty easy. But like I said, most of the dealers will carry an update card. You put that in, it's a master. It'll update. If it takes an update, it'll take it. If it doesn't need it, it won't take it. So, you know, if they do the software, the engineers find little issues with it, they'll correct it. If there's new products that are available that connect to it, the update will add that to it. It's really a good way to do it. So whenever there's a chance to update your unit, you want to do it. Okay, you want to keep it up, keep the latest update in it. Keeps it running well. Okay, other way to do it, any of the new units from the Gen 3s up, you can update automatically. Really cool. So if you have access to internet at your house, if your boat's there or at the marina, it'll come up on your screen immediately and say there's two updates available for your unit. You go in and put your Wi-Fi password in, hit yes, boom, the unit will just automatically update itself. So you don't have to cart it down here for John to do it. That's just a hint. Okay, what's new in Lowrance stuff? Yeah, the Gen 3s are still around. There's some good buys on them. There's the new carbon just came out. It's going to be issued this month. It's coming out. It basically, they went to a higher processor, so you got a little bit better dual core performance processor. You got a dual channel chirp. What's that mean? I can plug two transducers in the back of it and operate them at the same time. So I can have one at the top of the water column, one at the bottom of the water column. And then they change the screen, makes it a little better to see with sunglasses on. So that's the big thing that came out this year. Okay, let's talk a little bit about networks. And this is how we get all our information in there. So when you look at the back of the unit, of course you got your blue connector for your sonar, your power, then you got what we call an Ethernet plug. That's your yellow plug, and it's red on this one, but now they're black. Your smaller plug, that's your NEMA 2000. Okay, there's two different networks. All right, this is how the units share information and receive information from different products. So your NEMA network is your smaller network. This is where your engine gauges, stuff comes in, your GPS information will come in, stuff from the radios will come in, it all comes off of that network. And so here's kind of an example of NEMA network. I got my GPS antenna on the roof, it's coming down, coming into my network, now it's allowing all the units, everything tied to here to share. So the information from that's gonna go into here, come back and go up to my radio, now my radio knows where I'm at. I can pick up my engine information, it's gonna send it down like this, that's how I got that information to display on here. If I have a trolling motor or I have an autopilot, it's gonna come across the same network and share. Pretty much how that one works. Real easy, NEMA 2000's been around a long time. Everybody uses NEMA 2000, all right? That's the standard for transmitting data. So no matter who you have, they may be a different plug, but They usually make converters to it, but that information will share across the board. Okay, then there's the Ethernet network. That's they call a lot of guys just call it the yellow network. This is where you share your sonar data to others, units, your radar information, your weather information. That's going to come across here. So on my boat, 1, 2, 3 units are plugged in. Okay, so this is just like a big Y plug. Got 1, 2, 3 units plugged in, the radar's coming in, the 3D structure scan's coming in, and the box is powered. All right, you don't have to put a switch on it. There's a magical thing called a yellow wire on it. All right, keep this in mind, because I've had dealers cut them off. On the power plug of every unit and the power plug of every device, there's a yellow wire. Okay, you'll have, like this will have a power plus and minus going into it, right, for your 12 volt. There's also a yellow wire. That yellow wire is called the wake up wire. So what it does is it acts like a switch, so you don't have to wire one in. So if I connect all the yellow wires together, the minute I fire a unit off, it wakes up all the devices and tells them to come on. So I don't have to put a switch on this and a switch on that. It just takes them. As soon as I turn it off, it signals the device to turn off. If you don't put those on, even though you wired power to this, it's not going to turn on. So, and that happens. I see guys that come with a brand new boat, and they're like, my radar doesn't work. And I'll get down there looking at it, and I'm like, well, your wake-up wire's not hooked up. What's that? So keep that in mind. If you're trying to do your own wiring, it's very important. All right, so again, Ethernet comes from the unit. All right, it's gonna allow me to share information. So if I have a transducer plugged into this one, it's gonna share to this one, to the other one, to the other one, however many units I got. Again, NEMA 2000 is gonna be all your devices. This one's gonna be your radar, your weather, that kind of information will come across your Ethernet network. Okay, I want to add another unit. Okay, most of these units have internet in them now, okay, where they could, you can run another unit. So if I don't have it, I can add a GoFree device. I can read it on my screen on my phone. I can have a backup fish finder, or I can put it on an iPad. All right, so the unit itself, if it's a Gen 3 or higher, will transmit its own signal. You don't even have to have this across it. As soon as you pick up your phone and the unit's on, you can see all three of them operating. You can select it and bring it up on your iPad. So, well, how do you do this? Well, the first thing you do is you gotta get an iPad. So go steal your wife's, because you don't wanna use yours, because it might get wet. So put it in a waterproof case, Velcro it to the back of the boat, turn it on, there's an app you download, and you bring it across, and it'll run. Whatever I see here, or whatever I operate on here, will change both of them. Okay, so it just becomes a repeater for this. So it's a quick way to add another device. Works really well. The only thing it won't do is autopilot, obviously for safety reasons, because you can see us standing on the dock going. That's why those guys are engineers. They think of that stuff. They're like, oh, we'll know what those pro staff guys are doing. They'll be up there driving their boat while they're having a beer around the harbor. All right, you can do video on it. Okay, kind of cool. Real easy to do. The units now, they just have plug. So you have basically a Y plug. This is your power cable. Your power plugs into this. This plugs in the back of the unit. Very simple. And then you can connect a camera to it. So you can put a camera anywhere you want. Each unit will run one. So I can have a video display. It's kind of nice. I have one on the back of mine. I love it when I'm trying to dock or trying to get into like a fuel dock and I want to make sure I don't whack my kicker motor on the dock. And I'm pulling away, I can look back there. And there's occasionally those days of winter fishing where, you know, I'll turn it on and I'll be watching the rods while I'm in the cabin, you know, with the heat on. Just saying, you know. Okay, so let's get into a little bit more into the sonar part of it here. So, okay, in the old days, we used to tell you what, get out there, find bait. All right, you know, nowadays, the way these things would chirp and the technology that's available to them, you don't even need to do, I mean, you're not fishing dead water anymore. You will see fish, okay? You will definitely see fish. So there's some tricks, okay? Here's a single salmon, half a salmon, all right? So here's my slug trail. Boom, boom, boom. I'm going back and forth. I'm trying to mark fish, figure out where they are. Always zoom in. Whenever I'm up here, I always split screen, no matter what I'm looking at. So if I'm there going, 66 feet? I'm going to zoom in on this side so I get a little better image so I can see that fish a little bit better, figure out where it's at. Same thing here. I moved in, I zoomed in, I'm trying to figure out where that fish is in relationship so I get my gear to him. Okay, here I see a fish going into a bait ball. Again, if I didn't zoom in, I may not see this. So if you're trying to fish the bottom, you always want to be zoomed in. If I'm fishing the midwater, I'm going to zoom in on that area that I'm trying to target. All right, here we zoomed in again. I'm at 2x and I'm looking at this bait ball and I'm like, wow, there's something going on here. All right, I look at it again. There's a big bait ball. There's fish actually swimming in it. I'm at 2. Okay, now I'm going to zoom in a little more. I go to 6. Oh, there's the boomerangs. There's the fish moving right into it, the bait ball. It's like, see them actually swimming in and out. All right, so don't be afraid. You want to get as many pixels into that area as you can. So zoom in on it, your target area where you're trying to fish. Okay, these units, okay, nowadays, HD, right, high definition, just like TV sets, okay, they went from analog to digital. The minute they go to digital, they work a lot better, all right, just like your television set, the reception's going to be better, so the digital units are going to work better. So if you haven't gotten to the digital world yet, come see me, I'll hook you up, we'll get you set up. All right, so they'll read a lot deeper, just with the normal transducer on, without even going to the chirp or anything else, they work a lot better. You can play music on it. I got my song going here. So, got split screen, got the radar over here. Alright, now, how many people heard the word chirp? Okay, how many people know what it means? Okay, yeah, it's alright. That's the new buzzword. Alright, so what it really stands for, compressed high intensity radar pulse. Well, what's that do for me? Nothing if I just tell you that. But if I have it on my unit, it is night and day difference in what you see. If you're gonna upgrade to anything new nowadays, guys, regardless of whose it is, chirp. Think chirp. Chirp is the way to go. Okay, what it does is we've talked about the single pulse, right? Boom, and when it comes down, picks it up. Now what we're gonna do with chirp is we're gonna send an elongated pulse that broadcasts on the entire frequency band of the transducer. So as that transducer, if I'm running this 50 to 200, it's gonna go across the 50 and the 200 at the same time, create one long elongated pulse. That's going to go down, and the target recognition and separation that you see of the fish is incredibly better, way better, night and day difference. So there's a couple ways to do it. If you don't have chirp now, you can add a module, usually like a sonar hub, and that'll get you to it if you got one of the older units. If you got one of the new units, you can. Almost everything is built nowadays has chirp in it. All right. So the way the Lowrance units work, some people have chirp transducers. Okay, we can run a chirp transducer or a non-chirp transducer because the unit is the deucer chirp. Okay, some people, the deucer itself has to be a chirp deucer. I can make this chirp. Okay, I'm running a Lowrance deucer. This will chirp. This will chirp too. Which one do you think is going to get a better signal? Yeah, of course. Now, if I'm running a 1 kilowatt and I'm chirping it, oh yeah, way better. So, depending on the type of fish you're doing. Again, like I said, most of the new stuff, it's all built into. All right, so now, here we got an arch. We got a fish, single fish again. All right, there's a bunch of fish. Very easy to identify, right? This is when you start running the chirp, okay? All of a sudden, the images become clearer, the separation between fish, much, much clearer. So if I'm going in a bait ball, it makes it very easy for me to look and go, yes, worth spending my time fishing this now. Okay, so I notice there's fish in there. Okay, what's a single fish look like? Same thing. It'll mark. Bigger fish will show up as bigger. All right, what's a school of fish look like? Very easy to identify, okay? A little bit of tweaking with the chirp transducer, you can do some really interesting things. So this is, I definitely suggest you look at chirp if you haven't done it. Okay, what's new? Okay, this just came out at the Miami Boat Show. Okay, for you guys, offshore guys that like to fish hardcore, we're doing a lot of tuna fishing. This is a broadband, or excuse me, a sonar module. I got to test this. I've had it in my boat since October. What's so special about it? Well, it's got more power. All right, obviously. The box is this big. All right, so what it does is I can plug 3 transducers into this at one time. All right, and I can chirp all of them. All right, so now I chirp it. I get noise-free clarity on 3 separate ranges. So think about, I got high chirp set on my top water column, and I have that one set down on one screen, 0 to say 50 feet. Then I put another transducer, my 50 to 200 foot line, right? Then I have the other screen setting up from 200 to bottom on low chirp. Now, each section is split up in the water column, and I'm allowing that to run on each one of those. That's pretty cool. So that's what this will do for you. So that'll work. Even though it says Sumer, it will work on the Lowrance unit. Trust me. So.
Will chirp work on a side scan radar? Does it increase the clarity?
No, they haven't got chirp onto that yet. It's just 8 high definition, but not on the a side screen, but we'll get into that too.
That Simrad unit you got there, will that work on different brands?
Probably not. No, it's gonna have to be a Navico product. You know, they're all they don't come across the board that way. So
proprietary then?
Yeah, proprietary. So allows you. It's just kind of cool. The reason I'm showing you this, it's not for everybody, but it shows you where the market's going. You can see that they're driving towards chirp, and now they're driving towards splitting the screen up in different sections and allowing you to run different transducers. If you looked at back when we talked about the new carbon unit that came out, it's already got two plugs in it for two transducers you can run at one time. So you can see where we're going with this stuff. So they're all of a sudden they're gonna split the water into different water depths and say, okay, what do you fish? This is the best transducer to put for each one. So okay, let's talk about some other things. All right. Working down from the top of the boat, of course, you've got radar, weather, GPS, so charting, kind of important. Have good charts in there. You get your current flows. This is great when you're looking at a chart. I love this when I'm going out over the bar. I got different colors. I'm looking at the arrows. I've got the tides going out. I can look at the bar and go, well, it's yellow on this side. It's green on this side. It's red in the middle. I'm probably not going to go with the red, so I'm probably going to hit wherever the least flow is, because that's going to tend to be the less waves. So. And it'll show you what the flow is without having to dial in. If I clicked on it, give me current flows. But you can see that depending on where it is in the tide, it works really well. Okay, you can set up your screens many different ways. If you're old school and want to read the numbers up top and still have this down below and have the compass, you can do it that way. Again, charting, very important up here in the Northwest. We get a lot of days it's foggy, and you can't see from here to here, and you're trying to get into the dock to get out. You know, so be able to zoom in and have good clarity. So all the Lowrance units will run everything. So they do Nautic Insight, which is our chip that just gives you more definition as far as contour depth. Lowrance Insight Genesis is where you can make up your own maps, Navionics maps, and sea maps. So you can add any of those. All right, now since we added Wi-Fi to these suckers, we can go up here and go into, it actually has its own shopping cart. So let's say I'm up in Canada, and I wanted to buy an avionics chip for Canada. I could just buy it, download it over the internet to my unit. I don't even have to have the hard chip anymore. It goes into my unit, and if I'm networked, guess what? It shares across all the other units. So I only have to have one. I have three units on my boat. I only need one chip to be able to share information to all the units. Make sense? So you don't have to buy three separate chips like the old days. All right, if there's updates, we talked about it. If I wanted to upload maps to make my own mapping, I could do that in this page too. Okay, weather. Okay, us offshore dudes, we kind of like to know what's going on with the weather. What's going on here in the waves? What's going up in the hills? Are there storms coming in? I can zoom out pretty quick, tell where everything's moving across. All right, I can click on the buoy. Okay, waves, 14 seconds, or 14 feet at 15 seconds. Almost 30 miles an hour, water temperature. All right, let's go. No? All right. There are some guys, you know. All right. So I can look up here. I can see where the storms are coming to. All right, here I got a thunderstorm heading north, a couple of them heading up the beach. All right, so I can look at that. You can see I got wind barbs here. It's going to show me which way the wind's blowing. And again, the wave height. So for salmon, or for anybody that fishes the ocean, this is definitely something you want to look into getting. I can hit one of those. Whoop, there we go. If I click on one of these, I can actually find out which way it's going. Storm's moving at 20 miles an hour in what direction. All right, so it gives you quite a bit of info on the weather. It'll give you an alarm, too. Here I'm halibut fishing. All right, so I'm sitting up here, and I'm looking, and I got a storm alarm within 6 miles. Well, there's a storm, but I can see it's heading this way. So I'm like, I'm going to keep fishing. Now, if it was moving towards me, I'd probably move. But in this case, it's moving over here, so it's not a big deal. So you can set up that distance you wanted to alert you at. So another cool feature of it. And again, you know, again, you're charting. You'll be able to see all your waypoints as you're running. You got your weather. I mean, your radar overlay. You can pick up the rain as you're moving in. Okay, it'll pick up thunderstorms, lightning strikes. It'll give you that information too. All right, Insight Genesis. You mentioned making your own maps. Okay, if you look in most of these sonars nowadays, there's a place to record, right? You can actually record the data. So what you do is you put an SD card in, I turn it on the sonar record, and I just start running. I'm out there fishing, I do my thing. At the end of the day, I pull that card out, I upload the data to the site. They have a site. You upload it, it comes back, it makes a map, and sends it back to you. Okay, and at that point I could look at it. Now why is that important to me? Well, there's areas where you don't have maps. Okay, a lot of guys are trying to fish lakes and stuff, there's no maps, you can make your own. All right, which is kind of cool. What I like about it is I'm running out to go tuna fishing, I'll leave it running, and I'm making a map. I'll come back and you'd be surprised, you can probably ask Kerry over there, how many times you run over little bottom fish holes, all of a sudden there's little rises in the bottom, and I'll go back and scan, man, I scan through that thing really fast, I'm like, look at this, and I saved those numbers off of that, all right? And if I wanted to, I could, next time I was fishing it, I'd actually create, as I went back and forth across it, it's gonna create a better map. Now I download it to a chip, I stick the chip in, when I'm gonna go out and fish it, my map appears on my GPS screen, and I look at it and I can see exactly where I wanna be. So there's a lot of times you find those little humps as you're running, but you don't have time. Maybe you're going salmon fishing, maybe you're going tuna fishing. You can use that information later. So that's where this comes in. Okay, there's a subscription service if you wanna make the maps, it's not too bad. So, but like I said, it will give you pretty good data. You can go down to 1 foot contours. So if you're trying to build something up over, like going over a rockfish spot, you can get 1 foot contours, figure out where the fish are in relationship to it. It'll actually show you what kind of bottom it is, all that kind of information. So it's a way to go if you're looking to do that. All right, some of the other things that work well for offshore events. Okay, most of us have VHF radios. I would hope at this day and age, everybody has a VHF. I would hope everybody went to Boat US and got an MMSI number and programmed it into the radio. So if I ever had an emergency, this is connected by NEMA 2000 to my GPS source. So when I push it, it's gonna send out a signal, right? So everybody knows where I'm at. Because if I'm out there tuna fishing, when I broadcast over that, everybody with an AIS radio is gonna get that signal and go, oh, this guy's in trouble, this is where he's at. Coast Guard gets that signal. All right, so that's what the red button is. If it's not connected to your signal and it's not programmed with an MMSI number, it's not gonna work. All right, so make sure that that's done. Okay, the other thing it does is, most of them nowadays have what we call AIS, automatic identification signal. It's like a tracking system like an airplane. All airplanes have a transponder, right, so they can see it. Most of all your commercial shipping has transponders. All your commercial vessels have transponders. Most of the yachts have transponders, okay? This will receive only. So if I put this radio up and it's on AIS, that AIS signal is received to my screen. If I want to send a transmission, then I move to what we call a AIS 400. All right, this one has an antenna and a GPS receiver, and it will receive and send. So I can turn it on, and now all of a sudden, my information is broadcasted for the world to see. Okay. Fishermen like those when it's really foggy. We turn them on. As soon as we get where we're fishing, we turn them off because we don't want to broadcast. But you'll be surprised how many charter boats, here's a tip for you, leave their AIS on. And I can zoom, if I'm sitting in Tacoma, I can zoom out to the coast and I can see the AIS signals. And I can see who's fishing where. So that's just a tip, I'm just mentioning it to you. A lot of those guys, either they leave them on because they don't care or they don't know how to turn them off, but you can see where they're fishing. And some of the tuna guys, the commercial tuna boats, will have them on too. All right, so what's that show on your screen is? Looks like this. You got the little diamond with the arrow in front of it. So here I am, that's my radar signal pouncing off of one of them. All right, here I got a collision coming. It's avoiding, here's a boat coming. You see how it got darker? It'll start flashing, it'll give you avoidance. It'll tell you, hey, you're on an intercept course with another boat that's got the AIS on it. So it'll come up, pretty soon it'll give you an alarm. There's an alarm where you can set it to go off if it comes within so many feet of you. Or so many minutes, depending on how you want to set it. All right? You think there's a few boats with AIS? Yeah, they're out there, like I said. So you'd be surprised what you see. So now if I click on one of these, it gives me the name of the boat. All right? If I click on it again and open it up, I can actually find out what kind of boat it is, how big it is, where it's going. Yeah. So great way to safety-wise, to avoid it, you know, but if I was worried about it, I know who to call. I can get his number and call him on, hail him on 16 if there's an issue and say, hey, you know, we're getting ready to pass you or something, so whatever it's going to be.
You got a call button at the bottom of that screen.
What's that?
There was a call button at the bottom of the screen.
Yeah, there is. Okay, and one of the other cool things, using that same technology, if I have Kerry's MMSI number over here, does a lot of tuna fishing with us, and he has mine, which I do, and I wanted to know where he was, I could send a signal out to his boat without making a phone call, without just calling on the radio. And it'll come back and it'll say, oh, he's right here. So I don't have to respond. So you wonder why a lot of guys aren't talking is because I already know where they're at. We could track six boats at one time. So the guys that we have their numbers on will show up on our screen, so I know wherever my buddies are. So that could be done quietly. So, you know, that's the, one of the nice things about this technology it allows you to do. All right, we mentioned get all your engine information will come up on screen. So if you're tied into one of the newer outboards, boom, it will show up. They even come wired nowadays. If you look at the new Evinrude, it already has a NEMA 2000 port right on it. You don't even have to have an engine sensor. You just tie into the NEMA port. Boom, it comes down, ties right into your network that we were talking about. Everything that this motor puts out, I can see. So I look at the straight fuel economy right off the motor, the engine temperature, oil pressure, everything, whatever I want to look at. Okay, I can show it like I did before, or I could just have it up on the screen and have it like this, or I could bring it up on my whatever I'm key on. Like I said, I always look at my engine temperatures all the time. I like to watch those when I'm running, but everything I want, I can bring up and show on there. Okay, autopilot. Okay, yep. Easy to install nowadays. You want to have an autopilot? Got a 17-foot Arima. Put a cable steer in. Autopilot. Connect tie bar your kicker motor to the main motor. Your autopilot's up on your screen. Left, right, auto, turn, 10-degree turns. I just push the button. The boat's going to troll. Go back. I can play with my downriggers. Mama doesn't have to steer the boat anymore. Right? So do whatever I want to do. Makes great trolling out there for tuna, same kind of thing. Hydraulic unit, same way. All right, and you're like, well, that's great, but what if I don't want to run up the front of the boat to change it? Oh, key fob. Yeah, you can steer with a key fob. All right, so these, you know, relatively easy to put in nowadays to come with the kits, work real well. So, like I said, it's all built into the unit, so you can drive right off here. So the nice thing about this kind of unit, by doing it that way, is now I have it on my main motor, so I'm making a long run. I set my course, boom, I'm on it. You know, it's going to go to that waypoint and steer the boat, so I can sit back and drink coffee while I'm making my, you know, 50-mile run. Yeah.
Well, that's references only steering. Doesn't control throttle or
spoil. No, does not. It's only steering.
Can you manually override it just by?
Yep. Well, there's a button. You just push a button. There's like a red button. You hit the button. You can put it anywhere you want. So you hit it. You know, a lot of guys will have one at the back and one at the front of the boat. So, okay, radar, really important up here. So what do we want in a radar in the Northwest? Well, the way we fish out here, what do? We're different than everybody else. We tend to run really fast, a short distance, and then troll all day on a kicker motor, right? So if we have to run our radar, it's going to run our battery down. So we want first thing we want is a radar that's not going to draw a lot of power. So you want something that's a low power draw that you can run. Then you want something that's going to give you close in definition. So the old style pulse radars would have this main bang feature, right, where you can't see up close to the boat. Well, that's where I'm really interested because I don't want to hit somebody when I'm trolling. So if you can see the new style broadband radars allow each individual boat to show up. In this case, it's a bunch of pilings. You can see each one. They're so good nowadays, I pick up people walking on the beach. You can pick up kayakers, you know, you'll pick them up on the radar. So the radars have really come a long ways. So you get real clear. See, I can see anything that's around the boat. I'm on a half a mile, everything's gonna show up. Again, here's land, got a couple boats. So easy to operate, low power draw. They're what they call a green radar nowadays, which means if little Johnny climbs up there and is playing around in front of it, you don't have to worry about him riding a short bus because he got zapped. All right. We can combine stuff on screen, so I can overlay my radar on top of my GPS screen, so I don't have to run two different screens if I don't want to. So here I got some rain coming in. You can see I'm making a run, and or in this case I'm trolling. So I'm trolling along. I pick this up. I can pick up any boats. Works quite well. Here I'm making a move along the beach. I got the hole, I got the ferry, all the boats that show up. This stuff's really clear, really easy to use, and you can run it. Okay, to get the overlay on there, you've got to have an indicator for it, okay? So it requires a 0.1 module, and it's a GPS combination compass. The radar has to know which way the boat's pointed in order to overlay the information on it, okay? Make sense? If I don't have a compass going to it, it doesn't know. If I have an autopilot, I can use the autopilot compass, right? Just as long as it has a compass reading, it knows what direction it's going, it'll overlay the radar. Okay? New Precision 9 compass takes the place of this one here. This is an RC-42. This one's a little bit more accurate, a little less expensive. All right, tides and currents. Everybody should have tides and currents on their sonar, all right? You buy a unit nowadays, it should have tides and currents. Which one's more important for fishermen? Well, they both. I like to know when the tide change is, obviously, but more important to me is the current change. I want to know when the water's going to change directions, because it's a lot of times it's an hour after the tide change before it actually starts switching. Prime fishing time, right? Okay, then we got into side scanning. Out came structure scan. All right, ability to look sideways and see targets off to the side, okay, or down. And we get these 3D kind of imaging kind of pictures, you know, where they're like Etch-a-Sketch. You can see stuff. Pretty cool. That comes with this different type of transducer. Again, here's a 1 kilowatt. Here's a structure scan transducer. They're a little bit longer. Allows you to look under the boat, okay, and get a down image. Also allows you to look sideways out to the side of the boat and see what's out there. They were originally evolved to scan bottom and pick up structure. But fishermen immediately figured out, hey, I don't care what's on the bottom, but I really care about what's between the bottom and the side. So by tweaking them just a little bit, I was able to figure out, hey, I can see where a school of fish is off the side of the boat. So now it became very valuable to me immediately. So here's a down scan. Here we got a bunch of fish. We marked them on our sonar. You can see each individual one when you look at it on the structure scan. Yeah, that's a down scan image. Here's sea bass, okay? We marked that. Most of you guys are pretty familiar with this. Got a bunch of bass suspended. You can see each individual one over here. Okay, now we're starting to look a little sideways. Again, I got the bass under the boat. I got a split screen. I can see that they're to the right side of the boat. They're probably about 25 feet. All right, so what am I looking at here? Well, here's again down scan. You get these really cool images when you're down scanning. Here's part of a bridge. Easy to find structure if you're trying to fish, lean cod, that kind of thing. You can figure out where they're at. I can put a waypoint right on the bottom structure because I can go and cursor right to this and say add waypoint. And I'd be exactly on that piece of structure, okay? All right, you can pick up bait, okay? Again, I can see if it's to the left. The way this information transmits, this is the newest, this is the oldest, just like we talked about before. It scrolls this way. This is the bottom of the boat looking to the right side, to the left side, from the surface to the bottom and across the bottom. So, boom, boom. Follow me? It's cutting that edge of water out. All right, so this thing is called a transducer burst. Left, right, and then if I target something and I'm trying to fish it, I can tell that it's 80, almost 90 feet down, and it's 87 feet to the right side of the boat. This is kind of how you use it. So. I'm interested in is, if I was scanning bottom, I would bring this in where the bottom was sitting right here, and I could look across all this because I'm trying to find rocks if I was bottom fishing. But if I'm salmon fishing, or I'm tuna fishing, I don't care if I can even see this. If I'm out in 3,000 feet of water, I'm not going to see bottom anyway. But what I'm going to see is 0 to 600 feet out to the left side of the boat, and same on the right side of the boat. Now, anything that shows up in there is going to immediately, I target it and go, oh, it's 600 feet to the right side of the boat. So now, instead of the boat just having to drive over top of it and get that image as I go pass over it, now I cut a 1,200 foot swath of water through, or, you know, that I'm looking at. That's where the advantage comes in. Why is that an advantage? Well, think about it. How many of you guys coho fish? Okay, most of you guys in the room. All right. So what happens? You catch coho, right? You net it, you bring in the boat. Picture. Okay, put it in the fish box, and then you go, where'd the school go? All right, so I'm trying to figure out, I got to get back on the school of fish, right? So now, if I did a couple of S-turns, I turn that transducer this way and this way as I start back down again. Now, I'm swinging at 1,200 feet this way and this way, right? Now, all of a sudden, I'm going, oh, school of fish is right over here. I hit a waypoint. I'm right back on track again. That's how we use it for fishing. So now I've opened up that area. Same thing with tuna fishing. You guys are out there, you're drifting, and you've got tuna coming in the boat, and you're feeding them, right? And you get fish on, you can see where they are in relationship to the boat. You can say they're just out this far from the boat and down this far. sometimes they're down just far enough that you're like, ouch, you know, I got to get out the jigs, you know. So, but it's all that stuff will help you. So don't worry about the fact that you can't see this. We worry about what's between this and what you can't see. Okay. See, again, you can see what's on the bottom. Definitely, if you want to do the bottom thing as you're dragging through the harbor, be surprised at all the stuff you see out there. Right? Kind of cool. Here's a gill net. As we're going by, you can see the net hanging down. Okay. It would be hard to see on the standard sonar. Okay. Trees. You guys are doing a lake thing. You can see where your lure got hung up in. Okay. Here's a really good down images, pictures. Rock piles. I'm going fishing for bass, or I'm going fishing for lingcod. I can see what's down there again. If I put a target here and I set a waypoint, it's going to take me right back to this spot. I can drop right on it. Okay. I can measure stuff. I can graph a bottom if I want to. You know, I can see how big an object is down there. There's a lot of cool stuff that we'll do. I can find alligators in the lake. I just like this one. That's one of my favorites. You can see the how it images with that. Gives you that shadow effect. And the old bus with the bait on it. Okay. Yeah, they found it. What's the ship look like? Well, this is on a Cimarad unit. There it is on the bottom. Okay, crab pots. All right. Here I got my crab pots dropped. I'm going in. I'm going to see how many guys, you know, the buoys went under. It never happens to me, but you know. They put enough line on it, you got to wait for the tide to come up, but you're trying to figure out where it's at. You can actually troll over it with the structure scan and figure out where all that is. Or many times I'm going to drop a pot, and I'll be looking at it going, oh, geez, there's already three or four pots down there. I'm not going to put it here, you know. So it allows you to see that. It allows you to see the structure at the bottom. So if I have a lot of rocks and stuff down there, I may not want to drop my pot there. So that's another advantage you can look at.
What's the maximum speed that it all, the structure scan will fix?
What's the maximum speed it will look at? It's about 7 to 8 miles an hour is what it's designed for. So anything above that, it's not really. What's an airplane look like when it goes down?
Ugly.
Yeah, looks like an airplane. Did they find it? Oh yeah. Okay, this gives you a little better idea. So I'm out here on the lake, I'm making a troll. I'm scanning left and right, okay? Gets the idea how it works. Now, if there's kokanee in the lake or trout, if I was to come down and make a turn here and get this line out to this port and then make a turn down this way, within two turns, I've pretty much covered most of the lake. You think how fast it's gonna take me to find a school of kokanee? Not very long, all right? And then I can stay on. The same thing happens in the ocean. As I'm making a turn, I mark the fish here. My next turn around, I'm gonna go right back to here. If they're over here, I'm gonna go over to this side. That's how it works. It gives you an idea of what you're looking at. Okay. Then, gotta have 3D, right? So they took the structure scan and made it 3D. So they added an extra element in there. The way it works now is it comes in, kind of similar. Before you just plug the transducer in, now it comes into a box because you got dual elements. That plugs into that network we talked about, goes into the unit. All right, so what's that do for me? Well, it gives me a 3D look. All right, so here I am, I'm in 90 feet of water. I can look at the boat, see what's behind me that I just trolled over. Here's some bait, fish, right, as I move across. I can actually take that image and turn it around or swing it this way and look down at it. So if I want a down image, I can look at it this way and see how far. It gives you an idea how that fan is. It's not very wide, but it covers a lot of distance out to the side. So this is just another interpretation of what you're looking at before, but it's in a 3D effect that allows you to manipulate it a little bit more. So it will remember. So if I came down here and I'm marking fish here and I turn around and I'm looking back at it, I can actually see in the water column where I'm going, where the fish were, and I can actually go back to that spot. So it's kind of a cool effect. Again, there's many different ways. I can look at it down at the bottom, looking up, or any way I want in the water structure column. So it gives you some cool features that it does. Again, you can see that's how wide the pattern is. Again, you're moving over, you can see where those fish are. You can pick up, you know, be surprised about the stuff that you see down there. Okay. For you guys that didn't get enough of this, or you want somebody, there's a lot of times guys say, hey, I'm setting up a network on my boat. I'm not sure I got it dialed in right, that kind of thing. We have a Lowrance on the water training program. So we'll come out on your boat for a couple hours and we will not fix your boat, but we will help you dial your unit in to work correctly. Okay, and Larry Hutchinson does Oregon down here, so he's the guy that does it here. I do up in Washington. But we'll go through it and do the 3D, the networks, make sure we'll give you advice. We set it up where you can, how to dial it. We'll give you a list of recommendations and all your settings, so you'll have if you ever lost them, you'll know what to send them back to. We look at your transducer mountings, all that kind of stuff. So anything that works, anything you want hooked up, you know, we can help you dial it in. So that's just an option that's available. Okay. Now, some of the guys said, hey, Keizer fishes in Mexico and Panama and stuff. Well, yeah, I do. We have a tournament down there every year. It's a lot of fun. It's in November. This year it's the 2nd through the 6th. We go down to the East Cape area. Nice area. You know, Justin's got his marlin up there, you know, in the bar. He likes everybody to look at when we go. This is one of the rooms, one of the views. You can do rooster fishing. If you think a salmon fight's hard, try one of these. They're a lot of fun. Okay, where's it at? All right, most of you are familiar with Cabo San Lucas. Here's the airport. We just go north. We're on the Sea of Cortez. We're right up here. All right. From this area here, Alaska flies directly to it. So you come right in here. We pick you up at the airport. 45 minutes, an hour later, you're at the resort, ready to go fishing. Beautiful resort. Anything, it's a catch and release marlin tournament. Anything that's not a marlin, you can have filleted, vacuum packed. You can eat it there, flash frozen, bring it back, just bring a cooler with you. We have a big award ceremony on the last night. We give out quite a few prizes. They're not marlin tackle, they're stuff from up here. So this is kind of an example of stuff that we give out. So it's roughly about 10 grand every year that we do in raffle prizes. All right, this year, everyone's given an outboard. So how much does it cost to enter the tournament? It's expensive, it's like 60 bucks. It's a family-oriented event, so you'll get a lot of families to come. So it's mom, it's dad, it's the, you know, grandpa, the kids, the grandkids. I take my grandkids last year. I'm good now, so I'm not going to repeat it, but I did take them. So we end up like three girls that want to stay in the pool all day. All right, so marlin fishing's good. That time of year, all the species of marlin are there when we go in November, so you can get sailfish, blue marlin, black marlin, and striped marlin. So this has been doing it for quite a while. The cool thing about it, guys, is it's like 80 salmon fishermen from the Northwest going down there. And we're all white. We get in the pool, you know, we're all talking about the fishing. It's kind of fun. You instantly network with everybody else, so you have a good time. All right, so sailfish, you know, you get a lot of fish jumping and stuff. This is the resort. This is where you get on your boats at, so you're not very far from where you get out of your room. Don't have to go a road trip. We do a shotgun start the first day. Why? Because we can. It's fun. All right, so you get your fish in, you know, they'll release your marlin and they count the points. The team that wins gets to come back for free. Gets a spectacular fishing down there. Okay, the food down there is pretty good. They have a meal plan, or you can go out and eat. Most of us go restaurant hopping at night. There's all kinds of little restaurants in town. Real friendly town environment, so everybody's happy. We have a beach fishing competition one night, so whoever catches the biggest fish, as we're driving up and down the beach with the beer truck, they're dropping beer and bait off, wins that. It's just everybody puts in some money and have a cash prize. Okay, again, the pool, this is where you're getting on the boats at. Cabo would be way down there. Okay, we do a turtle release. We help support them with the turtles, so they'll release wherever they're, you know, several hundred turtles a couple times. So they let them go on the beach, and the loggerheads are trying to restore them. So they catch them. It's kind of fun. The kids just love it, you know. You see, they're all getting ready to hit to the water. If you haven't watched one of Justin's shows, he's done several from down here. So you can get on his webpage and see what's going on. Or come over and see me in the booth. I have a booth here for we're doing for them, too. For Van Wormer's Resorts, so fun place. Again, we'll give away the trophies, and of course the winning team gets to come back for free. Okay, what's cool about it? 5 days, 4 nights of fishing, or 3 days of fishing, 3 meals if you want to do the meal package. We pick you up at the airport, your tackle, reels, lures, taxes are all included. You guys can't go fishing in Canada for that kind of money. You know, you can get it down pretty reasonable per person. That's your room and your boat. So